He prince immediately knew who the lady on the horse was. He hurried towards the place where the horse stood. Pungjali also went with him. The others also hesitated at a distance. The mute queen had dismounted by then. She looked at the crowd behind her with some concern and said something in sign language to Pungjali. Grandma has seen something miraculous in the forest. She is calling us to come to that place, she said. The prince decided to go at once. He asked others to come with him. The dumb queen thought for a moment and nodded her head in agreement. While leaving, everyone was talking about the horse she was riding. How did this old woman get such a wonderful high-caste horse from Arab country? No army has come and landed in this area in recent times, there was no war. So how could this lady have got this horse? We saw a Chola ship run aground near the mouth of Thondamanar. A short distance from there, the coast of the island of Sri Lanka curved in a southeasterly direction. Often the sea water created small water bodies and large water bodies within the earth. It was from such a bay that the ship seen by Vandiyadevan and others that morning came out and went into the sea. Now the dumb queen led them in the southeast direction. She entered the thick forest. Something important must have happened as the prince's interest gradually increased. He thought that otherwise this old woman would not have taken us this far. Suddenly the scene came before their eyes. There was a gap in the forest. The water level is known. Some people were found dead on its banks. The stench of corpses was mixed with the stench of dried human blood. Lifeless human bodies and dried blood were not new experiences to those men who had experienced so many battlefields. However, the thought that something wonderful, mysterious, and terrible had happened here filled everyone's minds with curiosity and disgust. On closer inspection, it became clear that all the dead bodies were the bodies of Tamil Nadu sailors. "Hurry! Hurry, see if anyone still lives!" cried the prince. Those who came with him went near each body and started examining. The mute queen beckoned the prince away again. She took him to a tree near where the bodies were lying. Beneath the tree was a monstrous figure reclining. The one lying down is the man. But it was hard to believe. Wounds all over the body. From the wounds in the skull, the blood was pouring down the face and it was very scary. A small sign of blossoming appeared on the face of the woman who was expecting death every moment when she saw the prince. He opened his mouth and tried to say something. But his face became even more grim as his mouth was bloody. The prince excitedly went to him and sat down. "Bring water quickly," he shouted. The man said, "No, prince. Just a little while ago, this woman gave water. If she had not come then, my life would have been lost by now. Sir, I have reaped the benefits of coming here to betray you. God will not punish me for this again in the next world." When the prince heard his voice, he looked into his face. "Ah, Kalapati." In those days the leader of the forest was called Kalapati just as the commander of the army was called Talapati. "What is this talk? How did all this happen? What betrayal have you come to do to me? I cannot believe it," said. "Sir, you say so because of their good character. I have come to imprison them at the word of the traitors. Here is the order." Saying that, he took a leaf from his lap and gave it to Kalapati who was at Chagundaruve. The prince glanced at the leaf for a second. "What is your treachery in this? You have come to fulfill the order of the emperor? I came to know it and came running quickly. How did these tragedies happen? Tell me quickly," he said. "If you don't have to say it soon, you can't say it at all," said Kalapati. Then he often knocked and told the following story. Taking orders from the emperor, Kalapati set out from Nagapattinam with two ships. He didn't like that job. However, he could not disobey the emperor's order and left. On leaving, the Pula Vettare had given him certain orders. That is to say, on reaching Sri Lanka, the ships should stop at a separate place and first find out where the prince is. Then meet him in person and give him the emperor's leaf. Before that, Senadipati Kajumbalar Velar should not know this news. After giving orders to the prince, it is fine if he comes as well, otherwise he should be brought as a prisoner by force. Kalapati left with a heavy burden on his mind. Many of the sailors under him did not know why they were going to Sri Lanka. This increased his heartache. He hesitated how to tell them. After bringing the ships to the mouth of the Tondamanar and stopping them, Kalapati with some other sailors went to Gangesan sector. It was to inquire where the prince was at that time. Gangesan came back from the field to learn that the prince was traveling in the interior of South Lanka. By the time Kalapati returned, the sailors knew about the matter. Weren't there some close friends of the spoilers? It has been proposed through them. When Kalapati returned, the sailors gathered together and asked Kalapati. Have we come to imprison Ponniyin Selvan? They asked. Kalapati told the truth. We are in the royal service. We have to carry out the emperor's orders, he said. They said, we can't do that. It's not the emperor's order. It's the order of the peasants. Then what are you going to do? Kalapati asked. We are going to go and join the prince. There is no prince in Matatam. Otherwise we will surrender to Senadipati Kajumbalar Velar. No matter how much Kalapati tried to tell them, it was useless. Only about 10 people, including the intimates of the Palyavetarayas, agreed to stand with Kalapati. What can 200 people do with 10 people? Well, then go away now. Enjoy what follows. I'll do my duty as best I can, said Kalapati. Many of the sailors intended to take one of the two ships and sail away. And some objected to it. So they got off the ship and set off by land. In their haste to depart, the ship they had boarded did not drop anchor. The ship drifted and broke aground and buried itself in the ground. After this Kalapati did not want to be there with another ship. He had heard a news in Gangesan field. They said that a few days ago an Arab ship had been wrecked near the island of Mulaith, and that some of the wild Arabs who had escaped from it were prowling about. So, he didn't want to have another ship docked next to the one that ran aground. He removed the ship which was in good condition from there. The sea took him to the Guda, which had gone into the earth, and anchored it. Then Kalapati went ashore with the sailors who were with him and consulted with them about what was to be done above. He went alone and told the prince that he would add command and that the others should keep the ship safe until then. The sailors expressed their concerns to the captain. While Kalapati was daring them, some men surrounded them and attacked them with hair-raising screams. It was known that they were Arabs. The Tamil sailors did not expect this attack at that time. Not ready for a fight. No knives in hand. However, they fought hard. All of them lost their lives fighting. Prince. I alone, mortally wounded, ran and hid for my life. I had kept my life till now to tell someone what had happened. Prince. I have had the privilege of telling them in person. I have reaped the reward of my treachery to them. Ponniyin. Forgive me and go away. Let go. Said Kalapati. Duty warrior. Why should I forgive you? If there is a hero's paradise where soldiers who die on the battlefield reach, you must also go there. No doubt. Saying that, the prince rubbed Akalapati's burning forehead. The tears that flowed from Kalapati's eyes then mixed with the blood on his face. With great difficulty he raised his hands and caught the prince's hand and held it in his eyes. Prince's hand was wet with Kalapati's tears. There were tears in his eyes too. For a while, Kalapati's life left his body.